Hello guys and welcome back to the last and the final video of our Instagram cloning tutorial. And over here we will be integrating the front end with the back end part of our application. So in our last video tutorial you have seen that how we have created our REST API using the Spring Boot application. And in this video tutorial we will be integrating that REST API that we have created in our last video with the front end part of the application. And over the course of this video we will be also learning how to integrate the Firebase application with the front end part of our application. And at the end of this tutorial we will be deploying entire front end as well as the back end part of our project into the cloud server. So without wasting much time, let's start with integrating the front end with the back end part of our Instagram cloning app. But before proceeding, don't forget to like and share this video. And if you are new to my channel, don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon so that you never miss an update from my side and you are always ready for your next interview. So let's start with integrating the front end with the back end part of our application. And to start with the integration, let's open the two projects, the front end in the Visual Studio and the back end in the Eclipse. So let's first open the Visual Studio and open our InstaClone application. So this is our UI code which we have implemented and left off on our second video. So let's run this project first. So we'll go to Terminal, New Terminal, and over here we will run this application. So our project is up and running. Let's go to the browser. So over here you can see our UI for the Instagram app is working absolutely fine where we have left off. Now let's start our backend server, that is we will start our Spring Boot application. So let's go to the Eclipse and let's start the backend project. So over here you can see this is our project which we have built in our last tutorial. So let's run it. So great, both our front end as well as back end are running successfully on different ports. So let's now start with the integration of our front end UI with our back end APIs. So as usual we will first start with our sign in page. So let's start with the integration of the sign in page, that is our authentication page, with the Firebase application where we will be building our authentication mechanism. So let's first go to our Firebase application project which we have created in our first video. So this was the project that we have created on our first video called as InstaClone. So let's start with integrating the authentication system of Firebase application with our sign in page over here. So first we'll go to our authentication over here. And over here we will click Get Started to start the authentication setup. So the provision by which we will allow the user to log in to our application is by typing the username and the password for the signup mechanism. And that is why over here from the list of mechanisms that can be provided from the Firebase application, we will be choosing the email and password option over here. So let's click this option. And over here we will enable this option by selecting this toggle button over here. So if you want some additional functionality like as passwordless sign in, you can also keep this thing enabled. But as of now I will keep it disabled and I will click on save. So the email ID password feature got enabled over here. As you can see the status is marked as enabled. So let's go to the user. So over here you can see since we have no user over here, the total number of users over here is 0. So let's start with the authentication system. So we'll first go to the documentation of this Firebase application by which we will be integrating the Firebase with our application. So we'll go to Firebase documentation. So over here, since our platform for which we will be integrating this Firebase is type web, we will be selecting here web as our platform. Now since the first thing that we will be integrating is the authentication system. So on the left hand side of the panel, we will try to find out the authentication documentation. So over here you can see that we have the authentication documentation over here, and over here we will select as web. And over here we will be selecting the fourth option, that is the password authentication, since over here we have selected the email and the password as our mechanism for authentication. So let's go to the documentation. So over here, you can see we have some dummy code provided over here already for our authentication purpose. So let's start with the integration of the Firebase application into our project. So the first thing that we will be doing is we will be installing the Firebase application into our project. So over here, we will open our UI project, and over here, we will install the Firebase application. So let's go to the documentation again. So over here, we will click the first help document, that is how to add the Firebase into our project. So over here, you can see that it has given a detailed description of how to incorporate the Firebase application into our project. And I am going step by step over here so that it will be easy for you to integrate within your code. So let's go through the integration process slowly. So over here, the first thing that you have to do is you have to install Firebase SDK into your project. So we'll copy this line, that is npm install save Firebase, which will install the npm package for the Firebase into our project. So we'll go to our terminal and paste it over here, and let's install over here. So this might take a couple of minutes. So we are done with the installation of the Firebase. Let's now import the Firebase packages into our project. So we will again go to our documentation. So over here you can see, according to our documentation, you can import Firebase module into your application by using this following commands. So let's do it. So what we will do, instead of implementing all the codes within our login page, we will create a separate component for our Firebase application. So in the component level, we will create a JS file called as firebase.js. And over here, let's import the Firebase into our application so that from any component, wherever we need this Firebase component, we can simply import this Firebase component into our project. So let's import the Firebase packages over here. And over here, we need to configure this Firebase application into our project. So over here, we'll go to this Get Started with Firebase, and we will click on Adding Firebase to an App. And over here, we'll select as Web. So over here also you will see that all the configuration that you need to do for Firebase application is stated over here. So over here we have to initialize the Firebase into our app. So we'll copy this thing and paste it over here. So what we have to do is we have to provide the Firebase configuration into initialize app so that it can create a relationship between our project and the Firebase application. So let's create the configuration. So we'll again go to the documentation. So over here you can see the configuration file is already present. So we'll copy this thing and we will paste it over here. This means that we have imported a Firebase project into our application and we have done the configuration for this project. So what are the metadata and the value that you have to put over here? I will be telling within a short while. So let's first create this configuration. Now the next thing that we have to do over here is, since we will be taking the advantage and the functionality of Firebase authentication and Firebase storage, we have to configure these two things separately. So the first one is the Firebase authentication. So let's export it from this package so that we can use this as a separate component. So that's it. We are done with configuring the Firebase into our application. And now we can use this configuration file anywhere within the project. Now let's provide the metadata that we need over here so that we can create a relationship with our local project with the Firebase application. So let's go to our Firebase application that we have configured. So let's also create the storage bucket for our project. So we'll go over here and we'll go to the storage. And over here again we will click on Get Started. Now click on Next. So over here, you will be given the provision of placing the storage location in the cloud based on your location where your application will be used more. So as of now, I will be keeping it like Asia and click on Done. So it's creating the default bucket for us where we can upload all the images and files that we will be saving over here. So great, over here you can see that both our authentication and as well as the storage has been configured successfully, which we can use in our project. Now let's again set up the configuration for our project. So the first thing that you have to do is you have to create an application over here. So over here you can see that you can create an iOS application, an Android application or a web-based application. So over here, since we are creating a web-based application, we'll select this option over here. And over here we have to provide a name to our app. Let's give the name as InstaClone. And since we are not hosting our Firebase application, let's click on Register App. So we are done with registering our app. Over here you can see that we already got the configuration file over here, which we need to set up in our project. So as of now, let's click on Continue to Console. So we are done with setting up our project in Firebase application. So the last and the final activity that is pending for integration is setting up the configuration file. So over here we have already declared the configuration file. We just have to put the correct credentials over here so that our app can talk to the Firebase application. So let's give the correct configuration over here. So the question is, from where we will get this configuration file from our project. So we'll go to the Firebase application, and over here, after you're done with setting up your database and the cloud storage, you have to go to this setting icon over here, click on project settings, and over here down the page, you'll get the entire configuration that you need to do for your application. So we'll copy this configuration from here and we will paste it over here. And that's it. We are done with configuring and integrating the Firebase application within our project. So let's now move to the implementation of the authorization system. So we will go to the login page.js where we have all the codes for the sign up and the sign in for our application. So first we will go to the sign up component. So over here we will open the signup.js, and over here we have all the code for the sign up activities, which is nothing but this sign up page that you can see over here. So let's start with implementation of this signup module for our application. So the first thing that we have to do over here is we have to import the Firebase application over here. So over here we have imported the Firebase packages. Now let's start with the implementation with the signup page. So first we have to understand that what we have to do over here. So as of now, forget about the Firebase application. Let's do some basic implementation of the signup module. So as soon as the user will land to this page, that is the signup page, he or she will put some value over here and click on sign up. We have to capture all this value from here and we have to submit all this value to our Firebase authentication system. And if the user has been authenticated successfully, the Firebase will send a positive response from its server and we have to move this user to our homepage. So that will be the flow of implementation. So first we have to capture all the values that will be provided by the user. So over here we'll go to our application, and over here we have to capture all the values that will be provided in this text box. So for that, what we'll do, we'll first create some state variable over here to capture the values that are provided by the user. So the first value that we have to capture is the mobile name or the email ID. So over here, since we are using the email ID as our authentication criteria, we will capture the email ID over here. So let's create a variable called as email. And let's for the first time provide a default value as null. Now the next value that we have to capture from the text box is the name. Then comes the username and the password. So that's it. These are the four values that we have to store, and we have to send these values to our Firebase application. Now the question is how we will store the values that have been provided by the user during signup. So for that, what we'll do, on this input box, that is the input text box over here, we will place an onChange listener. Means whenever there is a change in the text box, those values will get captured into the variable. So let's implement that. So over here for the first text box, we will place an onChange listener. And over here, we will be creating a function that will capture the email ID typed by the user. And within this function, what we will do, we will store the value that will be provided by the user into the variable called as email ID. So this.state.emailid, that is our variable, equal to event, which is coming from this text box dot current target dot value. So basically what this function will do is, on putting any value onto our text box, it will capture the value of our current element and it will set the value within our state variable. So let's save it. So over here you can see we're getting an error called as the provide email is not defined because we have not put this over here. So let's provide this and save it. So now you can see that our project is compiling successfully. Now let's go to our browser. So over here, just for testing, what we'll do, we will open the Chrome Developer Tools and we'll go to the function that we have created just now. And over here, this is the method that we have created to capture the value entered by our user. So let's put a breakpoint over here to see whether the values are coming or not. So let's type some values over here. So you can see that as soon as I type something over here, it had hit the breakpoint over here, and you can see the value of this current target element is P, which we have entered within the text box. And thus this value, which is P, is getting set to our email ID, which is our state variable. So in this way, we have to keep on capturing each and every text box over here. And after we are done with this input box, on clicking on sign up, we have to pass all those values to our Firebase application. So let's incrementally implement all this feature. So let's remove the breakpoint over here and let's go to our code. So over here you can see that I am calling a function called as provide email on change of this text box. And I'm creating a separate function to implement the functionality. So since it's a one line of code, instead of creating a new function, we can write the inline function over here. So let's minimize the code over here. So what we'll do, instead of calling the function separately, we will do an inline functioning over here. So it will be the same code, just the way of calling will be different. So we'll get rid of this code. So instead of creating a new function, we are using the lambda functionality over here. So let's do the same thing for each and every text box over here. And let's change the values over here. So this will be the name, because we are capturing the name over here. This will be the username and this will be the password. So I think you got the idea. So whenever the user is typing something on our text box, an event is getting generated and the value of the text box is getting initialized within our state variable that we have initialized over here. Now on clicking on submit, let's call a function that will call our authentication functionality so that we can authenticate the user using the Firebase application. So we'll write a function over here on onClick of this button as new signup. So on clicking on new signup, we will call the authentication method defined in the Firebase application. So for that, we'll go to the documentation of the Firebase application. So over here, under authentication, we have to go to web and we will go under password authentication, since we are using the email ID password as our authentication mechanism. So over here you can see that our documentation clearly tells that if we are creating a new user, we have to call this functionality provided over here. So let's copy it and paste it over here. Which means that on clicking of the sign up, we are actually calling the method which is defined within the Firebase. And over here in the parameter, we will be passing the email ID and the password as the request param. So let's pass the email ID and the password entered by the user. So it's too simple, right? So what we are doing is, over here we are assigning the value to the variable, and on clicking on sign up, we are passing those value, that is the state variables, into the Firebase authentication functionality. So let's run it. So over here you can see it's showing that the Firebase is not defined because we are importing the components in the form of storage and authentication. So over here what we have to do, instead of firebase.auth, we have to give auth as our variable. Now just save it. So now you can see there is no error in the console. So let's go to our application, and over here for the debugging purpose, let's open the Google Developer Tool over here. So we'll go to the source, and over here we'll be providing a breakpoint over here. So let's put some dummy value over here and let's see whether our functionality that we have implemented is working or not. So we have provided all the values over here. Let's click on sign up. So you can see that as soon as we have clicked on sign up, our control went inside the new sign up component. And over here you can see that the value is password, which I have typed into the field, and this value is undefined because we have done some mistake over here. So let's go to the code. So the reason why we got an undefined over here, because I have provided the name of the state variable as email ID and I have passed the value as email. So let's change it to email ID and let's click on save. So let's go to the browser and refresh it one more time. So we will again put the dummy value within our signup component. Let's click on sign up and let's check the value that is coming over here. So you can see the value that is coming over here is technicalinterview@gmail.com that we have provided here in the text box and the password that we have provided over here. So the values are coming correctly. Let's click on play to see whether we are getting any error or not. So you can see that our authentication was successful and it went into the success function that is over here. So let's see now what data we have received from the Firebase application as our metadata. So if I hover over here, you can see that there are plenty of metadata that I have received for this user. So over here you can see I got a refresh token, a unique ID for this user, as well as you can see we have got the email ID and some other metadata over here. So let's click on finish and let's go to the Firebase application to see whether we got a new entry or not. So over here let's go to the authentication and let's click on refresh. So over here you can see that we got a new entry within our Firebase database and that is technicalinterview@gmail.com which we have created just now. And this is the user ID of this user which we have created right now. So great, you can see how easily and smoothly we have created the authentication system for our signup mechanism. So the next thing is whatever the metadata that we are getting from our user, we have to save it within our DB so that we can use this metadata for our future use. But that we will do after some time. Let's also implement the sign-in component for our Instagram app. So we'll go to our sign-in component over here and we will do the same thing also over here. First, we will import the Firebase from our project. And then we have to set all the user ID password in our state variable. So over here we'll first create some state variable. So now let's set the value of this email ID and password from this text box. So we'll again create an onChange listener over here. So we are done with setting the value for our email ID. Let's also capture the value for our password. So we'll copy the same code and over here instead of email, we will assign password. So we are done with capturing the text. So now let's create the login functionality. So over here, we already have created a function called as login and we will comment out this code and we'll go to the Firebase documentation. And over here for the sign in, we will be using this code provided over here. So let's paste it. And again over here, we will change this firebase.auth to only auth. And over here in the parameter of this function, we will be assigning our state variable. So great, we are also done with the signing component. So let's save it and let's see in the browser whether this code is actually working or not. So the project got built successfully. Let's go to the browser. So this time we will be using the signing mechanism over here. And we will open our debugger tool so that we can debug whatever happening over here. So since this is a sign-in module, let's first give the correct user ID and password that we have used for our signup component. And let's click on login. So over here you can see we got the values as technicalinterview@gmail.com and password as password. So let's run this code. So you can see I got successfully authenticated over here. So we are done with our success case. Let's give our wrong user ID and password over here and let's see what really happens over here. So I will give a random user ID and password and let's click on login. So you can see that the user ID that I am passing over here is technicalinterview@gmail.com but the password is a random password that I am giving. So let's see whether it gets authenticated or not. So I'll click on run. And over here you can see that this time I am not in the success block, rather I am in the catch block and the error message coming in the response is telling that the password is invalid or the user does not have a password. Means this is a not a valid password for this email ID. So great, our authentication service is working just what we have expected. So let's now integrate our backend code and let's make it a full-fledged login component. So we'll again go back to our code. And now what we have to do from this success block within the sign up and sign in, we have to call our internal API that we have created in our previous video. And over there, we will be passing all the metadata that we are getting from the Firebase into our REST API as the request param, so that we can save all the metadata of the user into our database. So I hope you guys have understood the concept what we are trying to implement. So since now we are done with our integration of the Firebase application over here for the authentication purpose, let's now integrate the backend API that we have created in our previous video. So what we will do, the metadata that we are receiving over here after sign up, we will be saving all the metadata into our DB using the post request that we have created in our API. So what we have to do over here in our code to submit this metadata into our database, we have to create a post request over here which looks something like this. Means over here we will be targeting this URL with the method as post, and in the request body we have to send a parameter which looks something like this. So let's first start with this implementation. So what we'll do over here, whatever the metadata we are receiving, we have to create a payload over here. So I'll copy this payload from here and let's set the values over here. And over here, we have to create an AJAX call to push this data into our database. So the way by which we submit the data to the database is by using the method called as fetch. So this is the basic syntax of sending a payload or a request into the backend server. So let's understand what we are doing over here. So over here using the fetch call, I'm submitting the frontend data into our backend server. And the type by which we are submitting the data is post. Since over here we are trying to save the data of the user. And the data which we are sending to our database is this payload over here, which we are doing a stringify over here and sending this as our request param. So this is basically the flow by which we submit or retrieve data from frontend to the backend. So let's now call the backend user API so that we can submit the data. So the endpoint that we will be using for submitting the data is localhost 8080/user, which we have created for saving the user metadata into our DB. So in the fetch call, we will be pointing this localhost URL. So I hope this method is clear to you. So let's run this code and see whether we are getting any error or not. So over here, let's add one more condition called as catch, which will catch all the exception that we are getting from our backend. So let's save it and let's test this in the browser. So let's go to the sign up over here and let's put a debugger into our code. So let's provide some dummy data over here and let's see whether we can connect the database from our frontend or not. So over here, since already we have some dummy data set over here, so obviously the username by which we are trying to log in will not go into the database. Rather, it will get saved by these credentials over here. But let's test this functionality first. So let's click on sign up. So over here you can see, just like previously, we are sending the user ID and password over here. So let it go and get authenticated from our Firebase application. So you can see we got successfully authenticated over here, and that is why we are in success block. Now let's see whether we are submitting this data into our database or not. So let's click on run. So over here you can see that the payload that is getting created is this thing, which is an hardcoded string right now. Let's click on play again. So over here you can see we are getting a network error over here, which is nothing but a course error, which is highly expected if you are doing a local development. So what is actually a course error? It happens because your local UI is running on port number 3000 and your backend server, that is your APIs, are running on 8080 port. And since there is a difference in the port number, that is why the browser normally do not allows us to operate between the two different ports. So there are plenty of fixes that can be easily available for this type of local development. So either you can use a Chrome extension or you can turn off the security setting for your Chrome browser. So over here, what we'll do for the local development, we will be using the Chrome without the security setting. So for that, what you have to do, you have to open the terminal window or command prompt for Windows. And over there, you have to open Chrome by this following command, which I will be providing you in the description. So what it does, it disables the security feature of Chrome and then opens the Chrome browser. So let's click on enter. So you can see it's opening a new tab for Chrome, which is not secured. So since this browser is not secured, try to avoid using any bank transaction or anything that is related with some personal information. So let's open the localhost over here. And let's do the same sign up activity from here. And let's click on sign up. So over here you can see we got successfully authenticated using the Firebase. Now let's see whether this data is going into the DB or not. So let's click on submit. And yes, you can see there is no error, means the data got submitted successfully in the DB. So let's check it out in our MySQL server. So over here you can see that our data got successfully submitted over here. Let's now pass the valid data over here so that it will be more easy to understand. So over here what we'll do, we will replace the hardcoded user ID with users that is coming from the firebase.uid. And over here the username and the name will be the value provided by the user during sign up. So we will set the state variable over here. And for the profile image, we will keep it blank as of now. So let's save it and let's do an end-to-end complete flow of the signup activity. So if you go to our Firebase application, you can see that these are the two entries we have right now. Let's create a new entry. So let's do it. Now let's submit this data so that first we create the user into our Firebase and then save the metadata into our database. So let's click on sign up. So over here you can see we got the user created into our Firebase. Let's check it out. So yes, you can see that demo123 got created. Now let's submit this data into our database. So as you can see, the request got successfully submitted over here. So let's check in the database. So great, you can see we got a new entry over here, that is demo123, and the corresponding user ID is coming from the Firebase application as you have seen in the metadata. So also if you want, you can add the email ID over here as one more field for your user data. So that is totally your choice. So over here you can see that how easily we have integrated the Firebase with our application as well as our REST API with our front-end application. So let's do one more thing, and that is the sign-in. And over there we do not have to submit it to the database, rather what we have to do is whenever the user puts the correct credential over there, if the user has been authenticated successfully, we will be transferring that user to our next page, that is the home page. So let's do it. So in the sign-in component over here, if the user puts the valid credential, then from here, we will land the user to our next page, that is the home.js. So for that, what we'll do, if the user has been authenticated correctly, we will save the user metadata into our local storage, which we have implemented in app.js. So over here, if you remember in our second tutorial, when we are implementing the front end, over there we have implemented this logic that if the user data of the local storage is null, then the user will land to the login page, otherwise in the home page. So since now user have put the correct credential, we will set the user metadata over here, which means that this value will not be a null or undefined, and thus the user will land to the home screen. So let's set the value to this variable. And then we will reload this page. And we will do the same activity for sign up also. So we'll copy this one. And we will paste it over here. So I hope this flow is clear to you. So let's do an end-to-end testing over here. And let's click on submit. So if this flow works, what will happen is an entry will get created in the Firebase as well as into our local DB, and the user will land to the next page, that is the home page. So let's click on sign up. So amazing, you can see how easily we have validated the user and made the user land to our next page. And if you really want to know in detail what we have done with this local storage, let me show you that also. So just open the Google Developer tool and over here go to the application tab and then go to the local storage. So over here you can see that this is the user variable which we created on correct sign-in. So initially this was empty, means there was no entry over here, and if the user has been authenticated correctly, we are putting an entry over here and keeping this as a flag. We are redirecting the user between the login page and the home screen. So let's delete it over here and let's now reload the browser. You will see that if the user data is not here, our application will land to the login page. So let's test that function. So let's click on refresh. So over here you can see, since there is no entry over here, we have successfully landed back to our login page. So perfect, it is working as we have expected. So let's also check for the sign-in mechanism. So over here we will be giving the user ID which has already been signed up. So that is technicalinterview@gmail.com. And bingo, you can see we have implemented both the sign-in and sign-up quite easily over here. So I hope you have got the entire flow of how we have incorporated the Firebase application with our UI, as well as how we have incorporated our backend APIs with our frontend. So this is the basic mechanism by which we talk between the frontend and the backend. So in this way, we will be keep on integrating each and every component that we have created so that we can get a full-fledged Instagram application. So let's start with our next feature, and that is submitting a post over here, where on uploading an image, we will be submitting the image into the Firebase application and we will save the metadata into our local DB. So let's start with the implementation of the next feature, and that is integrating the post service over here. So let's start with the implementation of the next module, that is the upload button over here. So we'll go to our code. And over here we have to go to this section which deals with uploading the images for our post. So we'll go to our mainpage.js, and over here if you remember, this was the upload icon that we have implemented over here. But this is a plain image over here, and using an HTML component, that is image, we cannot upload any images over here. So over here we have to introduce a new type of put field, and that is the input type as file. So over here we will change our code a bit. So what we'll do, we will introduce a new HTML tag, and that is input type file. Let's click on save. So if you see that after the introduction of the input type as file, we have got an upload button over here, which actually deals with uploading the file from our local directory. So what we have to do, we have to style this upload button in such a way that it should look something like this, so that it not only looks beautiful but also fulfill the purpose of upload. So we will go to our code, and over here we will surround this image tag and the file upload button with a div over here, and around this image we will introduce one more tag, that is a label tag. And do remember, the ID that you are providing over here should be the name of the for tag over here, otherwise this functionality will not work. So let's save it. So over here you can see we have still the image as well as the upload button over here. So let's get rid of this upload button over here. So for that we'll go to our code, and over here in the CSS we will make it as invisible. And we will target the input text box that we have created, and over here the display will be none, which means that it should be hidden to the user. So let's save it. So over here you can see right now we do not have our input text box right now, but we have an image over here which performs a similar activity done by a file uploader. So let's click on this upload button. So you can see that is giving the option to upload a file into our server. So I hope you got the implementation idea over here. So let's write the code to upload the images to our Firebase application. So for that, we will again go back to our Firebase documentation. And this time over here, we will be using the storage for our Firebase. So over here right now, you can see our storage is empty because we have not uploaded anything till yet. So let's go to the documentation for the storage activity. So we'll go to the Firebase documentation, and under storage, we have to select Web over here. And over here, select the upload file to get the sample code for uploading a file to the Firebase system. So if you go through this documentation, you can easily find out the way how to upload an image to the Firebase application. So it is quite simple. What we are doing is we are using the storage as a reference and we are attaching the image over here. And over here, by initiating an upload task, we will be uploading the image into the Firebase application. And on state change, means on each and every iteration of uploading, it will give the snapshot of the upload, which means it will show you a progress bar. And over here on the success, it will give you the metadata for the image upload. So let's copy and start with this implementation over here. So let's go to our code, and over here, let's create an upload functionality over here. So from this code given over here, I have filtered out the code that is only needed for us. So I have removed all the comments and everything provided over here. And this is the code which is actually needed for us. So over here, you can see we are defining the upload in a variable. And over here on change of that function, we will be getting a snapshot which will give a progress bar. And over here on successful uploading, we will get the metadata over here. And the metadata will consist of the URL of the image that got uploaded in the cloud storage. So let's start with the implementation of this function. So over here, we need to call this upload functionality on change of this image upload. So we'll give an onChange listener over here. And from here, we will call our upload functionality, which means that once we upload a file, this onChange listener will get called, which will hit the method we have described over here. And now over here, we have to set the image name and the image that is being uploaded. So to get the image name and the image, we need to drill down within this event object. And to get the image detail over here, what we have to do, first we will create a variable called as image. And over here, we have to get the metadata of the image, that is the image name and the image content. And to get the image details from here, what we have to do, we have to drill down within this event object, which is getting generated while uploading our image. So over here, within this event object, if we try to access the targeted object, we'll get the content of the image within the files that are getting uploaded. So since we are uploading only single file over here as an image, so file 0 will be the content of the image. So over here, within this variable image, we right now have the content of the image that is getting uploaded. And from this image variable, we are getting the property that is name. So one more check we have to do is whether the value of this image is null or not. So if the value of the image is null or it is undefined, we have to return from here. Which means that user have not successfully uploaded the image. So let's save this code and see how it is working in our browser. So let's put the breakpoint over here for easy debugging. So let's upload an image over here. So you can see that as soon as I uploaded an image over here from my local directory, it have hit the upload functionality over here. And over here, if I try to see the value of this target element, you can see that event.target is nothing but the input file uploader over here. And within this files object, we have the image that is getting uploaded over here. So this is the name of the image and the file is of type image. So great, we got the absolute path of the image. Now let's start with uploading this to our cloud server, that is the Firebase storage. So let's proceed from here. So you can see that image has some data, so obviously it will not go within the return statement. So it will go to the line number 52. And over here what it will do, in our storage, it will first create a folder with the name called as images. And within that images folder, it will upload the file that is over here. So let's proceed with the upload. So I'll click on run. So there is no error. And over here you can see that it went within the success block, which means that the image got successfully uploaded to our cloud server. So let it get pass. So you can see that within this course of uploading, we have not got any error during the upload process. So let's now actually see that whether the image got actually uploaded to the server or not. So we will go to the Firebase application. So we will go to the Firebase application, and over here we just have to reload the page. And great, you can see that a folder got created, which is nothing but called as a bucket. And within this bucket called as images, the image file is there, which we have uploaded from our local directory, which means that our uploading logic is working absolutely fine. So let's start with some minute fine tuning of the code. So the first thing that we will be adding is we have to add a progress bar so that we can see that how the data is getting uploaded to our server. And for that, we will be copying this line for the progress bar and we will paste it over here within this snapshot block. And we have to also save the metadata of the image that is coming from our Firebase application. So over here for now, we will just log this metadata in our console. And over here, we have to provide a space where we can show the progress bar while uploading the image. So for that, what we'll do, we'll go to the mainpage.js. So let's create an empty div over here and put a dummy value as 20%. So let's style it first. So it's coming somewhere over here. So we want this thing over somewhat in the middle. So we'll attach a class name over here. So we'll go to the mainpage.css. And over here, we will provide the styling for this upload text. So it's looking more or less centered. We will go again back to our JS file. And over here, in place of this hard-coded string, we have to provide the percentage which is getting generated within this snapshot function. So for that, we will be creating state variable over here. And over here, we have to update the state variable every time we are getting a snapshot of our upload. And we have to show this progress bar status over here. So I hope this concept is clear to you. So what it is happening over here, the percentage of the upload is getting calculated over here, which we are populating in our progress bar, which is nothing but a state property. And over here, we are displaying the state property in our text box so that it can give a visualization upload for the user. So let's save it and check on the browser. So here you can see we are getting an error that it cannot read the property says state of undefined because this is not defined within this upload context. So we'll go back to our code to fix this issue. And over here at the top of the upload, we will create a constant variable to hold the context of this object. And we will be using this context over here. So let's save it and see in the browser. So we will again do a file upload. So this time, if you have seen that there was a upload status that was coming over here. Let me upload one more time so that it will be visible to you. So just focus on this value while I'm doing the file upload. So let me do it again. So over here you can see that the value is getting changed, which means that the file is getting updated with a progress bar. But if you want, you can easily do a fancy progress bar over here, such as you can show the percentage change over here, or otherwise you can directly use a progress bar, something like that. So it depends on your imagination and your way of implementation. So that I will totally leave on you guys. So let's now check one more thing, that what is the metadata that we are getting as our response. So we'll go to our console, and over here you can see we are getting in the console log the direct path of the image that is getting uploaded in the Firebase application. So this is nothing but the path of the image which is getting stored in the Firebase, and this is the data which we will be saving in our DB. So that while rendering the page, we will point the image file to this URL so that the content comes to our UI. So if you are confused, do not worry, stick with me. Just like before, over here also, we will be implementing each and every step in detail. So let's cancel this thing and let's check on the Firebase whether all the files got uploaded or not. So you can see all the three files got uploaded that we have tested right now. So brilliant. So everything is working as per our plan. So one more thing now, what we have to do is whatever the metadata that is coming from this Firebase application, which is nothing but this image, we have to save this in our local DB using the APIs that we have created. And for that, we will be using this post API to save the data into our database. So let's now connect our front end with the backend server, that is the REST API service. So for that, over here, we have to make our API calls. So similarly, like sign up, I will be copying the same code from here. And let's paste it over here. So this is the basic structure of uploading a file to our database. So let's now change it accordingly. So the thing that we have to change over here is we have to change the post URL over here, which will be nothing but localhost/post. So over here we will update that, and we do not need all this thing. We'll get rid of all this thing. Now let's find out what is the payload that we have to submit for the post URL. So for that we'll go to our postman, and over here for the post URL you can see the structure of the payload that we were supporting during our implementation of the backend was this. So we'll copy this thing and I will paste it over here. So over here we have to give the user ID, and you know that we have already stored the user ID of particular user on the local storage file, that is over here in within the application and within this local storage object. So we'll try to obtain the username and the user ID of the user from this object. So what we'll do, we'll try to get the object from there. So it's local storage dot get item, and the name of the item was user, and we'll do a JSON parse for that one. And from there we will try to get the user ID. So that's it, we got the user ID, and over here the post path means the image URL, which is nothing but this downloaded URL which we are getting as our response. Now over here we have to put a post ID, that is a random unique number, so that we can easily identify our image. So over here we have to generate a random number. So there are a lot of logic by which you can create a random number. You can get a timestamp, or you can get any type of algorithm to generate a random number. So for the demo purpose, what I will be doing is I will just call the math.random over here, and I will generate a random number of 5 digits. So this will be a simple dummy logic. And over here we have to pass a timestamp at which the file got uploaded. So that will be new date.getTime. And that's it. This is the payload for our post upload. So let's save this thing and let's see the output in the console. So hopefully this code will work. So let's go to our application and let's test this functionality. So let's upload one more file to see that whether everything is working end to end or not. So I will select one more file. So you can see we got a visual upload over here of changing the percentage from 0 to 100. And over here you can see the file got the uploaded successfully, and we are into the success block, which is actually uploading the payload. And once this got successfully uploaded in our DB, we are in the success block over here. And here you can see we got the data in response, which is actually the data that is coming from our DB. So great, everything is working absolutely brilliant. So let's pass this thing and let's now open the database to see that whether the data is actually getting persistent or not. So we'll open the MySQL server from here. So you can see that this is our MySQL DB, and the file got uploaded successfully over here. So over here the ID is 35, like counter 0. The post ID have not been generated over here. We have to see why. And this is the URL of the file upload. After that we have the timestamp, the user ID and username. So over here you can see, though we have passed the post ID and the user ID from here, but it have not gone to the database. So let's check it out why. So the reason why the post ID and the user ID was going null, because we have not declared this as a function, rather as a variable. So we have to do math.random with the curly braces and calling it as a utility function. And over here, instead of user ID, it will be UID, which we are getting from the Firebase application. So let's save it and test it for the final time. So I'll close everything and let's upload an image. So it's a 0%, 100%, and hopefully it went to the DB. So let's go to the terminal and see the value over here. So yes, you can see that the value got successfully uploaded over here. So here you can see the post ID got uploaded along with the user ID is also there. So everything is working as planned. So perfect, the entire uploading of the post is now working fine. Now the next thing is, once the user have uploaded the file over here, we have to show that, and for that we need to call our backend API to get all the posts uploaded by the user. And over here for that we will go over here, and if you remember that over here we have hardcoded the strings that are coming from our backend. So instead of hardcoding the strings over here, what we will do, we will actually make an AJAX call to get the data from our database. So we will again do an AJAX call to get the data from our database. And for that, we will be making the same API call. So over here, we'll copy this, accept this request option. So this will be the fetch call for retrieving all the posts that we have uploaded. So over here, this will be the fetch call for getting all the posts from our database. And we will comment out this thing because we will not be using the fake data anymore. So let's click on save. Hopefully some of the thing will work because I'm sure we will be getting some error over here because we have some garbage data over here for which we will be getting some error. Let's save it and let's see in the browser. But before that, one more thing I have to do is over here, I have to change the context over here. So this will be this context because otherwise we will again get the error in the code. So this context which we will be defining over here. If you are following my code from the first, I think you already got the concept of the React, how it is working and how we are integrating the front end with the back end. It is more or less similar. So let's implement this thing completely. After that, we will fast forward our video so that it doesn't get bored. So let's save it and let's see what we are getting on the output. So as expected, you can see we are getting an error over here. So let's go to the networker and see whether the data is coming fine or not. So over here, you can see that in the post call, we are getting a 500 error because we do not have a proper data on the backend side. So we have to just clean the data over here. So what we will do, I will delete some of the items from here. So since now we are connecting each and every component together, there will be a lot of related data between all part of the application. So it is better we delete all the entries in our database and we will do a fresh start so that we do not get any dummy data into our database. Because otherwise, if the dummy data exists in our database, we will get into exception and compilation error. So let me clean the dummy data. So I have cleaned all the dummy data even from storage and authentication, and we will do a fresh start so that end-to-end functionality works over here. So first we'll create a user called as technical interview and we will sign in using the technical interview as user. So if you go to the application over here, we got the metadata saved as our local storage which have all the metadata like the user ID and everything. Now let's upload an image over here. So the file got successfully submitted to the database. So if you see over here, though we have uploaded the file into our database, the post is not coming over here. So let's do a reload over here and see whether it's coming right now or not. So you can see a post came over here, but we are not sure where is the content over here. So let's now check out what is the issue over here. So you can see on the fetch URL over here, we are getting all the metadata that are saved in our DB. So it is not a problem with our backend, rather it is a problem with our frontend. Because the image that we are getting over here from our database, we are not able to display the image over here. And the reason why we are not able to show the image over here is because of the setting that is provided in the Firebase application. So we have to alter the security policy over there. So we'll go to the Firebase application. And we will go to the storage and under rules over here, we have to change this policy. And this policy talks about that it should read and write only to the user who are authenticated. So for the demo purpose, we will allow everyone to read and write our image that we have uploaded. So over here, we will remove the authentication from here and we will delete it from here. So let's click on publish. So this publish will take a minute or so. So let's wait for a while. So let's go back to our application and see whether the data are coming or not. So let's reload the browser. So still we are getting an issue over here. Let's put a debugger over here and let's try to debug it further. So the reason why we are getting this error is the data that we are receiving over here in the variable called as post path. And the reference variable that we are using over here for showing the image is post image URL. And that is why we are not getting the image into our front end. So I hope you got the solution. You just need to rename this variable over here. So let's click on save and let's see in the browser. And bingo, you can see we got the data that we are looking for. So obviously you will face a lot of issue while developing an end-to-end application like this. So I hope you know this is part and parcel of this coding, and if you do not face any issue, you will never learn coding. And one more issue you will find over here is, if I upload an image over here, as soon as I upload, you will see the change in the upload percentage, but the post is not getting displayed over here. But if we do a browser reload, at that time, the image will be coming over here. Means this div that is over here is not getting automatically refreshed. So we have to look into that thing. And one more thing is, you can see that the latest post should be at the top. Rather, over here, the latest post is going at the bottom. So this is the two issue that we need to resolve over here. So the first thing is this automatical refresh. So we'll go to our code. And over here, after the file have got successfully uploaded to our DB, means over here, we have to call this function that is getPost, which will refresh the canvas for us. So we'll do a this context.getPost. So this means that while you are doing an upload, it first gets uploaded, and once it is getting uploaded to our database, after that you are refreshing the canvas one more time so that the image you have uploaded comes to your timeline. So let's save it over here. And one more thing you have to do is, the data that you are getting, that is the array, this array is sorted in the ascending order of the ID. So you have to reverse this sorting. So you can do this sorting algorithm in the backend or in the frontend as you wish, but it is a good practice to do all this logical operation in the backend. So what we'll do, we'll go to our backend code. And over here in the post service class that we have created, over here we have to sort this list in the reverse order. So we'll use collections. So let's reload the server. So the server is up and running. So if everything works fine over here, if I reload the browser, what will happen is, over here, this content will switch based on the timestamp. So this post having the latest post ID will go at the top and this will go at the bottom. So let's reload the browser. So yes, so you can see that the latest post is coming at the top followed by the older post. So let's do an end-to-end testing. So we'll upload an image over here. So brilliant, you can see that the image got successfully uploaded over here, and after that, this content also got successfully updated. And thus we are done with uploading the post feature over here. So hopefully you have understood each and every component we have implemented so far. So implementing of the post and the status will be more or less similar. So I will be skipping it as of now. So let's move to our next component, and that is the comment box over here. So let's start with the integration of the comment box with the backend. So implementing the comment section is not a tough job. It's just establishing the connection between the frontend and our backend REST API. So let's start with the implementation of the comment box over here. So what we have to do is, to provide a comment for a particular user, the user have to write a comment over here, and on clicking on enter, we have to capture that comment into our DB, as well as we have to show that comment over here. So let's start with the implementation of this feature. So the first thing that we will do, we'll go to our mainpage.js, and over here within this post component that is over here, we have to implement the logic of comment. Because over here we have the section which deals with the comment box. So here you can see we have already provided a text box for the user to put their comments. And on clicking on enter, we have to capture the comments from here. So we'll write on key press, and we will write a function over here. So this means that on clicking on any key on the keyboard, an event will get generated, and it will hit the function which is called as submit comments. So we'll create a function called as submit comments. So this function will be responsible for submitting all the comments of the user into the DB. So the first thing that we have to do is, we have to capture the event that is coming from here. So if the event, event.key is equal to enter, which means that the user have clicked on enter, at that time we have to capture the comment of the user and we have to submit it to the DB. So first we will capture the comments posted by the user. So if the comment is not equal to null or undefined, we will post this comment into the DB. So over here we will make the Ajax call. So what we'll do, we'll again copy the Ajax code from our sign up over here as our template for the Ajax call, and we will paste it over here. So the URL that we will be hitting for submitting the comments in our DB is /comments, and over here this will be the payload that we will be sending from our front end. So let's copy this too, and over here we'll change the URL to comments. So let's create the actual payload over here. So the comment that user will be submitting will be this comment which we are getting from our event object. So over here we need the timestamp of the comment, and over here we have to generate a comment ID which will be a random number generated during the runtime. So as earlier, over here also we will create a normal demo logic for generating a random number over here. So this will be our random logic for generating a ID for our comment, and for the user ID we'll again copy it from mainpage.js, because all this data will be same across our application. So once the user is submitting the comment, so this will be the random generated comment ID, this will be the user ID who is submitting the comment, this will be the timestamp, and this will be the comment he is actually commenting. So now the one thing that we need over here is the comment ID, which is very critical over here, because without a post there cannot be any comment, and there should be an interrelation between the comment and the post. So over here we have to give the post ID. So now the question is, from where we will be getting the post ID? So for that we'll go to mainpage.js, and over here if you remember that while we were developing this component, the mainpage.js, we have already passed the post ID as one of the parameter within our component, which means that this post ID is already available within our post.js. So let's see how we can get the post ID over here. So what we'll do, we will write this.props.postID which we are sending from our mainpage.js. So right now we have all the data. So over here you can see we got the compilation error because we have forgot to remove this code from this block. So let's remove this and let's click on save. So the code is absolutely working fine. So before start testing this code, let's first open our DB and let's first delete all the comments that are already there as our demo data. So we'll open our MySQL DB and we will first delete all the data that are already present in our DB. So over here you can see these are few of the data that is already present in our MySQL DB. So let's delete all these entries over here. So both the record have been deleted. Let's now test in our browser. So first we'll put a debugger in our code so that we can debug it properly. So let's provide a debugger over here, and let's provide a comment over here. Let's provide the comment as testing, and let's click on enter. So over here you can see that as soon as I clicked on enter, it went within our condition block, that is over here. Now let's start with the debugging of the code and see whether each and every component is working fine or not. So over here the value of the comment is testing which we have entered, so it went successfully over here. So if I see the payload, so over here you can see that the post ID is undefined, which means we have some problem in our code. So let's see the prop variable what is coming. So the prop variable tells that the name of this object will be ID, not the post ID. So let's modify that first. So over here instead of post ID we will give ID. So let's save it one more time and let's start with the debugging. So we'll reload the browser and let's put the comment one more time. Now it's ready for submitting the data to our DB. So let's pass it and let's see whether we are getting any error or not. So over here we have not got any error, means our code is working fine. So let's open the MySQL DB and let's see that whether the data is getting persisted or not. So brilliant, you can see that our data is getting persisted within our database. So this was the comment ID, this was the post ID, and this was the timestamp. So brilliant. Now the last and the final thing that we have to do is we have to show the comments over here that is getting submitted. We'll go to our code And if you remember, over here we have provided the hard-coded string for developing the UI purpose. But right now, since our backend is done, we will remove this hard-coded string and we will actually make our API call. So let's make the API call over here. And over here, if you remember our API structure, over here we have to pass the post ID as one of our request param. So what we'll do, so over here we have to append the post ID that is coming from our main page within the props variable. So this will give the post ID and thus it will hit the corresponding URL to get the response over here. So let's also modify this success block over here. So for that, we will be populating this comment list over here. So as soon as the data comes from this request, it will get populated within this comment list. And within our HTML tag that is over here, we will iterate over that comment list and we will show the comments in the front end. So let's test this functionality. So let's click on save and let's go to the browser and let's click on refresh. So over here you can see that for this comment ID, we are getting a response over here. So over here you can see I'm getting the response from our API. And over here I see a small issue in our code that there is a difference between the variable name that is coming from the backend and what we have declared in our UI. So we'll make that necessary changes. So over here it will be username with the N in capital and over here instead of description it will be the comment. So let's change that also. So I think now we are good to go. So let's refresh one more time. And over here you can see we are getting the response from our backend. So here is the comment. So this is the username who have provided the comment and this is the comment provided by the user. So let's do one more thing. On submitting the comment, that is on success block, we have to call the getComment API one more time. So let's put one more comment and let's click on enter. And over here you can see that the comments are getting submitted successfully. So let's provide a comment over here also. And let's click on submit. And you can see that our comment is coming successfully over here. So only few of the modifications that you have to do is after clicking on submit, this comment box should be made as blank. So I think that you can easily do it in your home. So let's click on browser refresh one more time to see that whether all the comments are persisting or not. So over here you can see that the comments are persisting over here. So no issue with that. So one more UI thing that I want to develop over here is, if you see over here, if I put random comments, the comments will get saved, but there is no limit on the number of comments that will be shown in the user front end. So I can put thousands of comments over here and it will keep on listing so. But I want only top 4 or top 5 comments to be here. So what I have to do, I have to just make a small change on the UI. So I will go over here where we are showing the comments. And over here I will just put a condition that if the index of the comment is less than 4, then I will be showing the comments. Otherwise I will show an empty span tag. So before clicking on save, let's see that over here we have plenty of data. So after saving this code, so what will happen, the top 4 comment will get listed out over here. So let's now click on save. So you can see over here as expected that whatever the comments you put, it will not be more than 4 over here. So if you want, you can make some additional feature like there will be one expander over here showing that there are more comments available for this post, and on clicking that post, it will expand this div and will show the rest of the comment. So I am not implementing all those details stuff over here, but I am expecting that you guys can easily do it at your home. So I think over here we are more or less done with our primary things, that is creating our sign up and the sign in page. After that, creating our home page and integrating with our backend. Also giving the user the functionality of adding their own post and comments. So this was some of the major functionality that you need to know for developing any application from the full stack point of view. Because more or less all the application deals with the same workflow of submitting the data to the database and then retrieving the value again from the database. So there are a few more things that can be developed over here, that is the status bar over here, where on clicking on this icon, a pop-up will get open for the user to upload an image or photos. Similarly, over here, we have to implement the like button for the user to like a particular post. So those code I'm not implementing over here, but you will get all the codes in the Git link provided below. So if you get stuck while implementing any of this feature, feel free to go through that code so that you will get a complete knowledge that is required for implementing those features. So hopefully you guys have liked this video and it was useful for you guys, because I strongly believe that using this prototype idea, you can easily brush up your skill set to create any huge scale application that you want to develop for your personal use or for getting a job in any top product-based company. So let's now start with the final activity of our project, and that is deploying this code base to our cloud server. So deploying into the cloud server is pretty easy and straightforward. So what you have to do, as we have shown in your first video, we have to go to the Heroku.com, and over here we have to sign up for our new user. So let's now log into that account and start with the deployment process. So as soon as you log into your Heroku account, you will land to the dashboard which looks something like this. So over here, to deploy your project into the cloud server, what you have to do, you have to create a new app over here. So let's create this new app as InstaClone, and let's select a region and let's click on create app. So deploying your project to the Heroku server is quite easy. What you have to do is you just need to click on GitHub over here, and over here you just need to connect your GitHub account with this Heroku account, and so on clicking on this button, it will get connected with your GitHub account that is linked with your email ID. So over here you can see that this GitHub account got connected over here. So now what you have to do, once we are done with posting our all the contents to our GitHub account, we just need to give our branch name over here. And once you give the branch name and click on search, it will select the branch name from there and it will start with the deployment into the cloud server. Similarly for backend also, we need to create one more project called as InstaClone backend, and over there also you need to deploy your private branch into this server. And once you are done with two activities, we are live and we are ready to go. But one thing you do not forget to change, that is over here, while we are making any API calls, we are using the localhost 8080. So instead of using the localhost 8080, what we have to do is we have to replace this URL with the URL on which our backend server is running, which means the endpoint that will be provided by the Heroku server. So for example, after deploying this backend into the Heroku server, if the URL of the backend is something like this, we have to provide this link everywhere where we have the localhost 8080, because right now our local REST API is not running on the local server, but rather it is deployed to the Heroku server. So we have to point each and every URL with the respective endpoints. So hopefully that makes sense to you. So I hope you guys have thoroughly liked this entire tutorial of how to create a REST API, how to create the front end using the React, and how to integrate the front end with the backend application. So if you have liked this video, don't forget to like and share with your friends. And if you are new to my channel, don't forget to subscribe and hit the bell icon so that you never miss an update from my side and you are always ready for your next interview. So see you guys on our next video where we will be implementing something new, something amazing. So let me know in the comment section that what is the next application you want me to clone for you guys so that it will be easy for you to learn the full stack development. So see you on the next video. Thank you.